groovefm.co.nz, and you're also listening to us on YouTube now. So welcome if you're a YouTube listener. Time for another interview. This time it's with Janet Hunt. Now she is the author of a wonderful book which accompanies a wonderful TV series which has just begun and is going through six or seven parts on TV One. It's called Our Big Blue Backyard, and it's New Zealand's oceans and marine reserves. Now, she told me all about this. She's the writer of it, but essentially the TV show is actually made by New Zealand's Natural History Unit. It's got a whole lot of stuff all about what's above and under some of our marine reserves and ocean reserves, and she tells me all about how they came about. What I didn't know was New Zealand was the first place in the world to have a marine reserve back in the 40s and 50s when it was first conceived, but it didn't actually come about until 1974. So how about that? New Zealanders love the sea. Most of us live within 50 kilometres, believe it or not. Yes, we probably did know that. Our big blue backyard takes us so deep into the wonder and the absolute magic of it all is all there. And this book takes us through chapter by chapter through each of the reserves, the big ones that are worthwhile. Apparently there's about 150 to 170 of these things now, possibly more, but it goes through the main ones. So I had a bit of a chat to Janet, who's an author and now a science writer, about our big blue backyard, and she told me all about writing the book part of the whole thing. What came first, the television show or the book?
The television show came first. It came from Natural History New Zealand, and they and Random House, between them, I think, decided that they would like to do a book, and they approached me and asked me if I'd like to write the book to go with the series, or sort of kind of a companion book. It's not really the book of the series, but it's a companion to that.
Yes, well, I noticed when you were writing it, actually one thing I do like about your writing, I have to compliment you on, is that it's got a sort of a slightly poetic mix of sort of comment and your own views on things, and then mixes it, which makes sense, and then mixes it in with the science, which can be dull and boring sometimes. So you've got that balance right, I think.
Oh, great. Thank you.
Particularly, I like the way that you sort of take the reader through this sort of journey, so they sort of understand it from a holistic point of view. Talking about marine reserves can, I guess, be one of those things that it has a three-dimensional element to it, and I love the story in particular around Goat Island. The initial one that actually you brought in the economic aspects to it, which came later, and the social aspects which come. We should explain that this was the first of the reserves, wasn't it?
Yes, that's right.
Fascinating about it is that by making it a reserve, it actually brought quite a lot of activity and you know, respect, I guess, for the area, which it probably didn't have before.
Yes, I think so. Yes, well, I suppose it kind of pointed it out and saying this is a special place, whereas before it was just, you know, another little town on the coast going north of Auckland, and it was, you know, nothing, no particular distinction. But once you had that reserve there, and once it sort of kicked off and got going, and the fish started to be not afraid of people anymore, and people began to see the whole ecosystem recovering and all sorts of new changes, things they hadn't expected, then it became, it became something more special. So Bill Ballantyne was the chap who promoted it the most.
Right.
There was another chap who suggested it. Sorry, I've forgotten his name just this minute. But, it was sort of came about because they had a marine, Auckland University had a marine laboratory there, and they had just established it, and the chairperson, the one whose name I can't remember, suggested one day we need to have a marine reserve, because they were realising that although they had the laboratory, they couldn't really be sure what was going on unless they could have a completely untouched, uncontaminated piece of water there. They could do their experiments and take their soundings and do all those things that they want to do. So he proposed this amazing new idea. Why don't we have a piece of coast where no one takes any fish? And took off from there. And so Bill Ballantyne was the chap who took it from that point, really. He was the director of the lab, and it became his baby, and he his name is sort of scattered throughout the book, really.
So this started off around about in the early 1950s, didn't it?
Yeah, 1964, I think, was when the lab was first established. And so, yeah, it took off from there.
It was about 74 or something, wasn't it?
Yeah, finally the signpost went up in 77, I think it was. Yeah, formally gazetted in 75, and 2 years later.
Which is quite a long period, isn't it? Had any other countries in the world had proper, you know, legislated marine reserves before that time?
I don't know that any had of that kind, completely no take. I mean, in the marine protection area, there are lots of different grades of protection. So there's some where people might say, well, you can't have commercial fishing, but you can still have recreational fishing, for instance. And so that's a form of some protection, but it's not total protection. So I don't know that there actually were any of that kind. It was very interesting and trailblazing, really. Yeah.
One of the things I found fascinating was his argument. I think you've published a little bit of one of the stories or arguments around, sort of talking about a little 12-year-old girl who could experience fish in their own environment, which must have been a relatively interesting concept for its time. I'm just thinking Kiwis generally think of themselves as growing up amongst a natural environment, particularly then.
Yes.
And he was saying that wasn't the case.
Wade Doak, the legendary diver and marine person who's mainly been focused around the poor nights, his idea is that every child in New Zealand should have access to what he calls a wet library. So so that not only can they go to the local library and get out a book, they can go down to the marine reserve or some equivalent area and they can experience the ocean as it should be. And so, yeah, so Bill Valentine... they've now got this program called Experiencing Marine Reserves, which is in Wellington too, through Tapu Te Runga, the marine reserve in Wellington. And so schools will go on this program, which means that the children go to a piece of coast where there is no marine reserve and they'll look at what's there, which is usually not much, or might be a few little fish or something, but nothing very substantial, and then they'll be taken to a marine reserve and they will see the comparison. And it's just a way of inspiring young people to become keen on the ocean, I guess.
So the interesting thing I find about marine reserves is this idea that you can't really run a fence around us or something. So how do you know you're there? And if you're a fisherman, for example, commercial fisherman, or perhaps, or even somebody with a net or something like that, you know, where do you know that you're actually okay to fish? And also, how do you stop the fish? there's a couple of times you mentioned sort of that the fish are tamer within the reserve because they're not afraid of people. What do? They get to the edge and go, oh, hold on a minute.
Well, actually, I guess that does happen. I mean, probably they stray out of the reserve and, oops, that's a goner. But, from the fisherman's point of view, I think, first of all, there are signs on the coast and around the edges of the reserve, so you can see that. There are also buoys, usually to marker buoys, to show the extent of the reserves. And in this day of GPS and so forth, people usually know where they are on the water, I think. So really, it's a kind of a responsibility thing from the fisherman's point of view to note those signs. And on top of that, there's always somebody around. There's probably going to be someone around. If you happen to be fishing within a reserve, you'll probably be tapped on the shoulder pretty smartly by somebody and told to just go out there.
It can be policed?
Yes, I think they are. Well, DOC, who are usually the people who are looking after most of the reserves, they keep a fairly close eye on them, I think, and other people. Because people are so passionate about them, people who are using the reserves in a non-take way, like divers and people like that, if somebody were fishing in a reserve, I think they'd be fairly smartly reported, probably.
Well, that's something that that's interesting. Is when it comes to reserves, are there different rules for things? I mean, are there some places like, I guess growing up in Wellington, we know that Kapiti, for example, is one of those places that you don't visit without special permission. Mainly because of the birds and what's above the water. I'm not sure everybody's aware that there's actually a reserve below the sea level as well.
Yeah, well, The main rule for a marine reserve is simply no take. Those two words, no take. Don't take anything. So there's no fishing, you don't take shells or little mementos, no feathers, no nothing really. So, but on the other hand, you are so welcome to go in there and dive and snorkel and swim and paddle around the edges and all that sort of thing. And so yeah, it's just the idea is to try and maintain it in as untouched form as possible. So there's not a lot of, you know, it's not hedged around with ifs and buts, really. It's because they've gone so absolute in their ruling, no take, then that means that you don't have to sort of worry about qualifications, really.
And speaking of qualifications, what qualifies you to write a book like that? What's your background?
Well, my background is not, I am, like, okay, here's where I confess. I am not a marine biologist. I'm not even a qualified scientist. I'm a writer. So I'm a writer and a researcher, and my skills and my training are actually in graphic design and English literature. So I've just sort of, you know, my pathway to here has been a kind of a bit of a, what happened next kind of thing. Sort of. So one thing leads to another. And I started off, I actually began by writing a book about Honi Tuwhare, the Maori poet. And then because I was a graphic designer, I was working at Random House, and they needed a book about the native forests. And I was on the spot, and somebody said, well, do you like to do it? So I wrote a book about New Zealand's wildlife, and one, you know, like I say, one thing led to another. And in the case of the Big Blue Backyard, well, the last major book that I wrote was about wetlands in New Zealand, and so, you know, they kind of go down from the, they go down right to the coast. Our estuaries are all wetlands, so there's a bit of a link up there, but yeah.
Bit of a connection
And actually, I suppose I need to say there that I draw on the research and the kindness of a huge number of people, the scientists and the experts and the people from DOC, and they're all, people are really, really helpful. So it's a kind of, it's really a team effort. My name gets to be on the front, but it's a team effort, and those people are standing behind me.
Isn't it always with these things?
Yeah.
And you mentioned before about the Natural History Unit, they've been doing the filming. Did you get a chance to go out with them?
No, unfortunately, that would be wonderful. But the filming was mostly done by the time I started working on the book, and I received a copy of the series. So I've viewed the series several times, and I also was in touch with the divers, some of the divers who had contacted me, and we talked about things that they'd done and where they'd been and what the experiences they'd had. So yeah.
Well, that's a good point. What sort of things were they sort of visualising? Were they getting support for where they were diving and filming? I mean, some of these places are quite dangerous too.
Oh, yes, it's true, yeah. Like diving with the great white sharks around Stewart Island.
Yes.
It was interesting because their filming was a major thing. One of the ones that was really interesting was talking to a chap called Kinner, with good name, Kinner Scolle, who in his diving experiences on a little group of islands called Open Bay Islands off the west coast, and it's a major breeding site for fur seals, and the mother seals would go off out to the sea, and all the little fellas would sort of spend their days splashing around in this what they called a surge pool, which is just a lovely little pool where the water washes in and out, and the little seals all play in there all day. And there's a picture in the book of Kinnett. If you look closely at that particular picture, you'll see a diver in that pool.
Oh, yes, I see him, yes.
that's the one where there's an amazing photo of the little seal first poking its head under the water and looking into the world that's going to be its future. So I always thought that was a fantastic photo. I love that.
I hope he took his pegs with him as well, because as I understand it, that island absolutely stinks.
Oh, yeah, that's right. He did say that. You can smell it from a long way off, yeah.
Well,
seals are not fussy, and I don't suppose seabirds are either, but I think it's mainly the seals. So it'll be dead fish and all that kind of stuff, as well as all the other excreta. Yeah.
Speaking of reserves, how many are there?
There's 38 at the moment.
Yes.
And there's another five in the offing, all down the west coast. Those ones will be, I'm not sure actually, I was just looking the other day trying to find out when they're actually going to become operative, but they're sort of in process. So those ones are on the horizon. And I anticipate that in a very short time there'll be more. You know, every now and then I'll hear a little snippet on the news. Somebody somewhere is planning another reserve. And, so at the moment, 38, there's a map at the front which shows you where they all are. And so you can see right from the Kermadecs up north, right down to the sub-Antarctic islands. They're just recent additions, those ones down there.
Yes, and I noticed there's a rather large collection of them in the Fiordland sort of area as well.
Yes, they're almost running next, you know, right next to each other, but just a little group, a special little group down there.
Which must be interesting because that's also a large tourism area down there as well.
Yes, that's true.
And also our major earthquake area.
and high rainfall area.
Yes. So I guess that's probably perfect for seeing the world from a growing point of view for the scientists. Must be great for that.
In fact, it's the rainfall down there that makes the Fiordland Reserve so amazing. The rainfall washes through the forests on those very steep hills, taking tannin out of the leaves, which is that sort of yellowy tea-coloured. It stains the water, the top levels of the water. Mm. And so things that would normally grow really deep down in the dark have migrated up and are around the walls of the fiords. And so you can see things that these amazing black corals, which normally would grow in the really deep waters, can actually be seen by divers just below the water. So that's an incredibly, very interesting story.
Is that something that's happened recently?
It would have been like that a long time. They didn't know that it was like that until, I think, Manapouri power station went in and divers started going in there, and some people just thought it was kind of a milky green, yellowy colour water on the top. But once you go through that layer into the layer below, that's when there's suddenly, whoa, look what's down here.
Mm. Something that fascinates me about the, New Zealand's sort of attitude to conservation, it's a real fine balance, and I know governments change these things constantly all the time, but we seem to have, if you look at our economic zone, which is probably larger than any other countries, I think, and then the recent marine legislation that's coming in about protection of particular areas, which intertwines with these things like reserves, no fishing zones and things like that. It seems to be a really strong culture for this. Are you getting that feeling?
Yes. Well, it's sometimes I think it's a one step forward, one step back kind of process. So it just depends on, there's such a multitude of things actually, like fisheries and quotas and all of those sorts of things, and I know that some of the marine scientists would prefer that there be nothing at all, no half measures really, as far as conservation is concerned. But I think that probably, all things, a little bit is better than nothing, and maybe in time it leads to the whole thing. With the poor knights were a good example, because at first when they made that into a protected area, it wasn't totally no-take. They still had recreational fishing out there, but the recreational fishers were taking out the biggest predators off the top of the food chain. And that has a ripple effect right down the food chain. So it was only once they said, after quite a few years, that they finally said no fishing out here at all, that they really got the huge recovery. But you're right, I think a lot of people in New Zealand are becoming very passionate about conservation. Sorry, coming back to your question.
And we're mingling a lot with tourism lately, even dockers, putting in the great walks and commercialising them to some degree. I guess there's a fine line between bringing the people in, paying for that and the respect, which is kind of a twofold thing, and actually trying to keep everything as protected as possible.
That's right, yes. Well, when I went out to the poor nights, the day I went out, I think I was the only Kiwi on the boat. The rest were all tourists from Germany, all sorts of places around, mostly from the Northern Hemisphere. And it was people like Dive Tutukaka, who are the people who took the boat out that day. They are amazing at both protecting the people who are on the boat and looking after the reserve as well. When you're out there, they make it very clear, what you can do and what you can't do.
Well, I guess you'd have to. I mean, it's their livelihood too, isn't
Absolutely.
It?
Absolutely, yeah, that's right.
Is there any areas that, in the sense of researching this book, is there any areas that people flagged up that said this should be a reserve but actually isn't yet, or may never be?
probably a lot, actually, but immediately to mind comes, say, Great Barrier, where they did propose a reserve and went a long way towards it before it was finally canned, just because of some, because some people were wanting fishing in a particular area. And I know that they are trying to working towards reinitiating that same, not that same proposal, but doing other things which might meet those similar needs. I think there's a lot of, there are a lot of places. The Otago area springs to mind. There's a whole bit of coast down there that doesn't seem to have any marine reserves, and you think about the Catlins and some of those parts around the Portobello, the marine laboratory down there, all those places there, you think, wow, nobody else has said that to me, but I, when I was doing the book, I thought, that's interesting, nothing there. You know that there's people, there's a whole, that whole area out on Tairoa Head where they've got the albatrosses coming in, and you think, well, it'd be an interesting place to have a marine reserve there, because they've got all those seals and sea lions and things, and the yellow-eyed penguins all hauling out in that area. It must be somewhere on the horizon.
The one that fascinates me is the debate over the astrolabe off Tauranga, and now that now that it's come to everyone's attention. I mean, I didn't even know it was there, but then it's that a very it's a very small thing, and of course it had world headlines. And there's like, what do we do after that?
Yeah, you mean with the wreck that's out there?
Well, yes, with the wreck, do we keep it? Do we turn it into a diving, museum or something? Do we restore it pristine back to the way it was?
Yes, which I know is what some of the people who live there would like.
Yes.
You understand is what they're like. I don't know. I'm a kind of practical kind of person, and I sort of think, well, without knowing all the details, it must cost a fortune to try and take something like that out, and if you just leave it there, well, I don't know. It's hard to say. In time, it will just become part of the seafloor and rust away. So I don't know how long we'd take it for that to happen. I can't really make it. I wouldn't like to say what should happen, should or shouldn't happen there, really. But you can see both sides of the argument.
You certainly can. Last question. You've had a chance to have a look at some of these marine reserves, either by research or visiting. Which one would you recommend?
Ah, right. Well, I think it's hard to go past the Poor Knights for sheer spectacular beauty, actually. I know that's sort of, it's almost a cliche to say the Poor Knights, but have you been out there?
No, I haven't.
No, it's I recommend for every New Zealander who's at all interested in the ocean to go out there. I'm not a diver. I would like to dive, but at this stage of my life, it's probably a bit late, really, to start trying to get out there and go down deep. But I snorkeled out there, and it was just a stunning thing. You know, you're right in the middle of these little wee fishes and all the anemones and all the colourful growth on the cliff walls and things, and you just drift around going, oh, wow, look at that. So it's just stunning. But, you know, any marine reserve that's near you, wherever you are, that's the place to go.
Yeah, indeed. Well, Kapiti, I guess, is ours, and the south coast is the other area in Wellington, of course.
Yeah, Tapu Tiranga. I understand out there there's huge, massive seaweeds out there, huge kelps and things.
Yes.
You probably have to pick your day down there.
Yeah, we certainly do. that's the fun.
yeah, exactly. But you've got that wonderful little laboratory aquarium place down there on the shore.
Yeah, we have down in Island Bay that's coming along.
Yeah.
It's interesting that's positioned right in the middle of a fishing village.
Oh, right.
Yeah, so you've got the sort of commercial side, but of course it's all done on a voluntary basis, and the fishing down there is small fry compared to the big commercial trawlers. So
that's worth
noting as well.
Yeah, and it's really good to have that coexistence, the people, the harmony and the compromise, people working together and accepting different positions on things. So,
I guess that's the future of marine reserves, really, isn't it?
Yes. Well, it takes a long time to establish one, and it is that process of working through. But those West Coast ones that we mentioned earlier, they've all been come about because of a large number of stakeholders working together and over quite a long period of time. Again, I think, but people like Doc and the iwi and the fishing people and all of those people getting together and working it out, and that's the way to go, really.
Indeed it is. Thank you so much, Janet Hunt.
All right, thanks, Tim.
Your book is called Our Big Blue Backyard, New Zealand's Oceans and Marine Reserves, and the TV series starts very, very soon, doesn't it?
Yes, I think 2nd of November, I believe.
2nd of November, so everybody tune in. I think it's quite a large series too, isn't it?
There's six episodes.
That's pretty good in this day and age for New Zealand television to manage that.
Yeah, three in the north, three in the south. Yeah.
We'll look forward to it.
Yeah, great.
Thank you for your time.
Thanks, Tim.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Groove FM is